morning. Welcome to Unity Presbyterian Church this Sunday. It's a beautiful Sunday. We welcome our retired former pastor, the Reverend J. Robert Gray, to our pulpit with happy hearts this morning. He'll be with us through October 3rd, which is World Communion Sunday. Thanks, Pastor Bob. A note to parents. Our next confirmation class begins next Sunday, September 26th, and runs from 12:30 till 2 o'clock in the afternoon. We also start our new adult study this week. What do you remember about what you learned in Sunday school or your confirmation class? Join other Unity family members as we spend a couple hours each week exploring our faith. That's Tuesdays starting at 10:30 a.m. The class will meet in the Sunday school room. Now, Jan Gray has a moment for mission.
Good morning. Good morning. It's an exciting and busy time at Unity. As Nancy mentioned, on Tuesday, we'll be starting our study, which is called Big God, Big Questions. It's at 10:30 to noon on Tuesdays for 7 weeks. Note that it ends at noon, so you can still go out to lunch together. And if you would like to get a book before the class, come and find me and I'll give one to you. Then on Monday, September 27th, we'll be doing our mission week. In the past, we've gone to places usually out of state, but this year we decided to stay in the area because of COVID. And so we'll be going to three different places. The first one on Monday and Tuesday is to an organization called All That, which mentors young people after school. And we'll be doing replacing ballasts in their lights, doing some carpentry, painting. And then Wednesday, we go to Black Lick Woods Metro Park, and we'll be replacing the boards on the boardwalk near the Nature Center. And then on Thursday and Friday, we're working with Habitat for Humanity to do some siding. Now, usually at this time, I'm asking you for food donations and some money to pay for supplies. Because we're staying at home, this year I'm only asking for some money to pay for some of the materials we need. For instance, we need 13 ballasts, which are $25 each. So that gives you some idea of the expenses we have. We have 15 people working this year, and so I hope you'll be able to support them. Then you may be one of the first people to walk on those boards, because this year the crop walk can be held in different places, and so we're going to be walking over at Black Lick Metro Park. Your donations provide food, water, livestock, tools and training for people, both locally and globally. This helps people to learn how to produce their own food and to take care of themselves. Heather Theodore has set up an online place for you to donate. I was amazed how quickly they took my money. It's very, very easy to do, and the information on that is in the newsletter. So you can donate, find some friends who want to donate with you. Walk on Sunday, October 3rd. We'll have lunch after church, so bring a lunch, and then we'll go over to the park. There are trails of varying lengths, so you can walk on the half-mile nature walk with that boardwalk, or there are longer trails also. So last week, Dan talked to you about the Peace and Global Witness offering, and I'm sharing two more places that you can donate. So I hope you'll prayerfully consider those and find which one speaks to your heart and make a generous donation. Thank you.
Now let us worship together by singing From All That Dwells Below the Skies, which is page 8 in your bulletin or number 327 in the book. Thank you. will you join me responsively in the call to worship? This is the day that the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and give thanks to him.
This is the day.
24 hours of living in the presence of God.
This is the Lord.
Who loves us, claims us, and continually renews us.
This is the day that the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and give thanks to God.
The prayer of confession. O thou who loves us with an everlasting love, we pause to reflect on our sins and shortcomings. For you ask for obedience, and we respond with apathy. You call for courage, and we run and hide. You beg for sacrifice, and we look for the easy way out. Remind us this morning of the call from the cross that demands from us our very best. Rattle our cages to shake us awake to the call to be your new creation. Forgive what we have become and make us into what we ought to be. We pray in the name of our Savior, who died even for the likes of us. Amen. Jesus has promised that those who confess their sins shall be forgiven. Confident of God's redemptive love and assured of God's pardon, we prepare to live again. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. Thank God for all of God's blessings.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you,
and also with you.
Now we can exchange some peace.
Sunday school for our boys and girls, and if they would head to the back and meet Ava at the back, she'll take them back to Sunday school.
Forever.
Our first scripture lesson today comes from the book of Mark, chapter 9, verses 30 through 37. They went on from there and passed through Galilee. He did not want anyone to know it, for he was teaching his disciples, saying to them, "The Son of Man is to be betrayed into human hands, and they will kill him. And in 3 days after being killed, he will rise again." But they did not understand what he was saying to them. They were afraid to ask him. Then they came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the way?" But they were silent, for on the way they had argued who was the greatest. He sat down, called the 12, and said to them, "Whoever wants to be first must be last of all and servant of all." Then he took a little child and put it among them, and taking it in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes not only me, but the one who sent me." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
This morning's second lesson comes from the Psalms, Psalm number 1. Happy are those who do not follow the advice of the wicked, or take the path that sinners tread, or sit in the seat of scoffers. But their delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law they meditate day and night. They are like trees planted by streams of water, which yield their fruit in its season, and their leaves do not wither. In all they do, they prosper. The wicked are not so, but are like chaff that the wind drives away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Wish I could say it's nice to be back. It's been 10 years. And I thought I was retired from this. Still makes me nervous, still scares me to death, but it's also good to look out among your friendly faces, some of whom I know, some whom I don't, and I'm looking forward to getting to know better. But it's good to be here this morning on this sunny September morning. You know, this used to be one of my favorite Sundays of the year. We usually called it Rally Sunday or Kickoff Sunday or something like that. It was the start of the fall season, the program year of the church. And if you look at the gospel lesson in the lectionary, you see it reflects that kind of joyous occasion. Jesus is mediating a dispute between his followers about who is the greatest. Who's number one? And so Jesus takes a child and he places it in the midst of his disciples. And he says to them, "Here is the greatest." Because when you welcome the littlest ones, when you welcome the least of these, you welcome me. And you welcome who sent me. You see, today is supposed to be a day of celebration, a day of frivolity. I have to say, I'm not feeling frivolous this morning. 10 days ago, our transitional pastor died. A pastor whom we've come to know and love was found dead at home. Steve had been suffering from cancer. He had a growth in his mouth. He was supposed to go through a regimen, a very serious regimen of chemotherapy and radiation treatment. He was preparing for that. And as he stood in the pulpit before us each week, we could tell he was suffering. And we worried each week about his health and his comfort. And so we sit here this morning under a pall of grief and sadness.
For us as the newly formed Unity Presbyterian Church, Steve's death is just one more tragic event in a long season of despair and distress. You see, Reverend Steve Garstad was called to be our transitional pastor almost exactly a year ago. His mission was to bring together this body of Christ, this body of faithful people. And he was called to unite us and then lead us on to the calling of a permanent pastor. Steve recognized that we were a blended congregation made up of three different churches. And he recognized that when we merged these three distinct and separate congregations, each of our congregations brought our own pastor. But this one unity church couldn't support three full-time pastors, and so we had to graciously dismiss each one of these pastors whom we had come to know and love. It was hard to say goodbye to Pastor Nate and Pastor Amy and Pastor Patty. And even today, in spite of Steve's dedicated ministry, there's still confusion and anger and sadness about the three pastors whom we had to say goodbye to. And then there's this whole COVID thing. We can laugh, but isn't it sad? What the COVID pandemic has done to our country. It's a global pandemic that they say, what, 1 in 500 people have died from it? It's decimated our businesses, our communities, our schools, and especially our churches. We've really struggled with what it is to be a church. I mean, how many things can you do on Zoom? And then when we finally got back together and were able to worship together in the sanctuary, along comes this Delta variant, and we're all masked up again and trying to keep socially distanced. So today, as God's faithful people, we're suffering a great loss. And I try to, in this sermon this morning, try to address the elephant in the living room, because it's obvious. Because as a people of God, we're sad and disappointed and confused and maybe even angry. We're not sure what tomorrow's going to look like. And we gaze out into the future, and what's tomorrow going to hold? Where do we go from here? With this church, which is our church, this blended church of all of us, it's our church, the Church of Jesus Christ in this place. And so this morning, for comfort and solace this morning and guidance, I'd like to turn to that first psalm. Personally, I find comfort and solace in the words of the psalmist. We remember that the Psalms were written when the people of Israel were experiencing their darkest days. They knew that they were the people of the covenant. They knew they were the chosen ones of God. God had assured them that they, as the nation of Israel, held a very special place in God's eyes. And so God had assured them, "I will make a covenant with you. I will be your God, and you shall be my people." Now, here is the image that the psalmist places in front of this faithful people. He writes that the faithful are like trees that are planted by a stream of water, which yield their fruit in its season, and their leaves do not wither. Trees planted by streams of water. You know, we sit here in the sanctuary, you can look out any window and see trees. Strong, healthy trees in full leaf. But think for a minute about the landscape of Israel, of Palestine. They lived in a desert with very little water and very few green, leafy trees. And so God's message to the people of Israel is in stark contradiction to the land in which they dwell. That where there is desert, God brings flowing water. Where there are scraggly bushes and withered vegetation, God brings luscious, fruit-bearing trees, loaded with the abundance of great things. And so God's covenant with God's people emphasizes two things. One is the emphasis on community. God's covenant with the people is not with individuals. You know, we may talk about the righteous man or the righteous woman. We may hear about the single person who does well in God's eyes. But God's covenant is with all of God's people, with the community of faith, with the church, with our church, God's covenant. And so for us, we gain our strength and our solidarity when we're joined together as the body of Christ. When we come into the sanctuary on a Sunday morning and worship the Lord, there is the community of faith. And so, secondly then, essential to the covenant with God is trusting in God's abiding presence. Like that tree that sinks its roots deep down into the ground to draw nourishment and strength, so do we draw our strength when we go to the Lord in prayer. So do we find our assurance and our encouragement from our Lord when we understand that God never abandons God's children, no matter how far we stray, no matter how challenging tomorrow may seem. God is faithful still. You know, I think Joyce Kilmer maybe got it right. I think that I shall never see a poem as lovely as a tree. A tree whose hungry mouth is pressed against the sweet earth's flowing breast. A tree that looks at God all day and lifts her leafy arms to pray. Poems are made by fools like me, but only God can make a tree. In the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. This morning, our affirmation of faith comes from the brief confession of faith. It's found in your hymnal, but it's also printed in the bulletin. Could we stand and affirm what we believe? In life and in death, we belong to God through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit. We trust in the one triune God, the Holy One of Israel, whom alone we worship and serve. Please be seated. We come before the Lord in a season of prayer, remembering those who are suffering in this time. We remember those whose names are printed in the bulletin: Bill and Marilyn Hoffman, Cliff Marr, remember, is it Marilyn Cook? Thank you very much, yes. Marilyn Cook, who's at the James in the ICU unit. Are there others we want to remember in prayer this morning by name or situation? Again.
Mary Bopar.
Bopar. Thank you. Others? Yes, in the back.
Mary Roberts.
Mary Roberts. Thank you. Nikki, thank you.
Eric and Kim Dickover, both suffering from COVID. Eric just got out of hospital last night.
What was the last name?
Dickover.
Dickover, thank you. There was one over here. Nancy, thank you.
Aretha Teeters,
thank you. Bonnie.
Terry
Yetica. Terry.
Cohen.
Terry. Terry Yetica.
Caleb Moses.
Right. Caleb Moses.
13-year-old.
Thank you. If there are others you'd like to pray for in the silence of your own hearts, let us go to God in prayer. Let us pray. O thou who loves us with an everlasting love, who is sunshine to our shadow and joy to our sorrow, hear us now as we pray the prayers of a faithful people. Lord, we come before you this morning to listen to those old, old stories of women and men who were faithful in times of trouble and brave in days of challenge. And so too, may we continue to be faithful and strong in our faith in Jesus Christ. As we remember the saints who preceded us to this place, common, ordinary women and men who were pioneers leading us through the wilderness. And so too, Lord, help us to become pioneers, beacons of hope in days of darkness. We pray for your church throughout the world, for missionaries who carry your gospel to far-off places, for willing workers who go to places in our world where natural disasters have blown homes off their foundations or burned up homes in wildfires. We pray for the people of Louisiana and Texas and the southern states who are dealing with the aftermath of Ida, for the helpers who are working to restore electricity and give shelter to those who are homeless. We lift up prayers for those who are suffering and sorrowful. Especially we remember those who are struggling with the coronavirus. Pray, touch broken lives, make them whole. We pray, Lord Jesus, that you would walk into our families and bring peace where there's heartache. Restore broken relationships where families are not talking to one another for one reason or another. Help these ones to come together as they remember the love of Christ that pervades all homes and families. We pray for one who this day mourns the loss of a loved one's. Especially do we pray for the friends of our transitional pastor, Steve Garstad. May there be some resolution to his passing. Comfort those who mourn. Bring peace where there's anxiety and lift up those who are down. We name ones before you, Lord God, either by voice or in silence. Be with Marilyn and Bill Hoffman, Cliff Marr and Marilyn Cook. Be with Caleb Moses, Mary Roberts, Mary and Tim Dickover. Watch over Aretha Teeters, Terry Yetica. Lord God, we know that you know their needs even before we raise them in prayer, but help us to be reminded of their suffering. Lord, in our silence, hear our prayers and hear us as we join voices together, praying that prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For
thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Now the saints of the Lord go out. Go out into the world in peace. Be of good courage. Love and serve the Lord in everything you say and everything you do. And now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with you all now and forevermore. Let the people of God say amen.
Amen.